Hey everyone, I'm Dan Stipp, the senior pastor of Lake Gregory Church.
And I'm Andrew Newberry, worship director here.
Hey, we just finished putting together the worship music and the message for this week. We're very excited that you're joining in with us.
This is our second digital weekend in a row of gathering. We can't meet in person, which is unfortunate, but it gives us an opportunity to still worship with our families. Ryan and Stephanie have joined me, and we're going to play some music for you. You will not see us on the screen when we're doing the music, but you will see some lyrics in front of you that you can worship with your family with.
And the message for this week is the beginning of a new series on Breakthrough. I hope that it's uplifting and encouraging to you and your family.
So worship with us, and just enjoy a really, really wonderful morning together.
Upon a hill, a perfect Savior, upon that day, the greatest love. The punishment that should have fallen on us, upon him, upon his head, a crown of thorns, upon his heart, a broken world, the wage of sin, the weight of our transgression. Upon him, upon him. Christ has died, we are forgiven, and Christ alive. We are the risen, and he shall come again. Praise the King, praise the King. Upon our hearts, his name is written, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. We're pouring out a song of praise together. Upon him, upon him. Christ has died. Jesus, Jesus, and Christ. died. We are forgiven and Christ alive. We are the risen and He shall come again. Praise the King, praise the King.
Before me, I know who
Hey everyone, at the beginning of this message, I want to ask you to think about a time in your life when you experienced a breakthrough. Maybe it was a time when you realized that you had the ability to do something that you admired, maybe in your siblings or your friends. Maybe you were 4 years behind your brothers and sisters learning how to ride a bicycle, and all of a sudden, it finally clicked. You finally felt it, and you were able to acquire this new skill. Maybe a breakthrough moment that you can remember happened in your teenage years. Maybe you got a band award for a competition, or you received recognition for something in sports, or there was an academic achievement or something that you received, some kind of recognition that you had an ability to do something. You discovered something about yourself through that and what you could do or accomplish. And it was a breakthrough moment for you, something that was securing and helpful to you positively moving forward with your life. Maybe it was a significant shift in your career path. Maybe again, because you recognized something about yourself or what you're passionate about, and you were able to make a decision and make a shift, and it was a breakthrough moment for you in your career. For me, the most important breakthrough, life-changing moment was when I came to recognize that Jesus Christ is exactly who he said he is, and that God longed for a restored relationship with me, and I gave my life back to him to let him take up his rightful place in my life. That was a spiritual breakthrough, life-giving moment. For some of you, maybe you remember a financial breakthrough. There was a time when you were in dire straits or struggling under pressure, and something changed in your circumstances, and you were able to have a financial breakthrough. Something happened that alleviated that pressure. Maybe you've experienced a medical or a health breakthrough. Maybe something was developed that was beneficial to you with particular health conditions that you have, or you experienced a turning point, a breakthrough in your own health that allowed you to navigate forward in a more healthy way. Or maybe it's a relationship breakthrough, a relationship that was distant or broken, and you longed for that closeness with a particular person, and there was this breakthrough moment of opportunity when maybe reconciliation took place or forgiveness flowed, the wall was taken down, and you were able to experience a healthier connection with that person. Everyone desires breakthrough, more than you are conscious of. Right now, people would love to see a medical breakthrough against the battle against COVID-19. Maybe you're longing for a breakthrough in your career or your compensation so that you don't have as much financial pressure. Maybe you would like to get back to work, or maybe after all this mess is over, you'd like to have different work than what you've been able to have for right now. Maybe you long for a breakthrough in your marriage or with a son or a daughter or a grandson or a granddaughter. Breakthrough is a very positive thing, and more than we realize, we all want it. The good news is that God wants breakthrough in our hearts and in our lives as much or more than we do. So why do we not experience breakthrough more frequently? Maybe it's because we're not in a posture, a frame of mind, a stance in which we can really recognize what it is that God is doing and what he wants to do in our life. Interestingly enough, as I reflected on this idea of breakthrough, and it's all over the scriptures, Old Testament, New Testament, I found that there were two different ways to think about this. One is a breakthrough when God breaks through to the hearts of his people. Another way that scripture talks about breakthrough is when God breaks out against those things that are opposed to our progress or the progress of the gospel getting to the hearts of more people. And all of that is wrapped up in this idea of breakthrough. So that's what we're going to talk about in this message, is how can I be better prepared for those breakthrough moments, those breakthrough opportunities in my life. It's all a part of a bigger series where we're going to talk about breakthrough in a number of areas of our life and seeing it from a number of places in the scripture. Today, we're going to be in Luke chapter 19, verses 28 to 44. And it is appropriate for this Sunday, April 5th, that we are reflecting on the significance of Jesus's, what we call his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, Palm Sunday. Why was that such a big deal? And what kind of a breakthrough opportunity does this reality of how Jesus was recognized as he came into the city right before the beginning of what we call Passion Week and ultimately his crucifixion and resurrection. Why is that so significant, and what opportunity does that provide for us to connect with God today? So while you're finding Luke chapter 19, beginning with verse 28, either on your tablet or your mobile device or through a copy of the scriptures that you have, I want to introduce this passage in a couple of different ways. First of all, I want you to know that this particular event was significant enough that it was recorded by every writer of Jesus's life and ministry. In what we call the Gospels, the four accounts from different vantage points of Jesus's life and work, every one of those writers included an account of Jesus's triumphal entry into Jerusalem. That in itself tells us that this was significant. You can find it in the passages that I put on the slide. And for this week, that might be a great place to begin. To begin reading with the triumphal entry, read through the Passion Week narratives, and reflect on what that means for your life today. But we're going to be focusing on Luke chapter 19 because more so than the others, it calls us to a place of preparedness. You'll see that by the time we get to the end of the message. Another thing that's important to get the most out of this message is to recognize what had been happening up to this point. We say, in our terminology, that there was prophetic silence for a minimum of 400 years before Jesus was born. What we mean by that is that God was speaking through various people at various times and in various ways, making his purposes and plans known. He was revealing himself to people. He was revealing himself through people. And over 1,400 years on three continents in three different major languages, God disclosed his plan to restore humanity to himself. There's a lot of gory stuff in there. We'll be talking about a lot of that. But overall, it was a plan of restoration. It was a plan of redemption to restore humankind relationally to God. But there was 400 years of silence since Zechariah and Malachi to the birth of Jesus. So there was anticipation. There was expectation that God would come through ultimately on his promises. But from generation to generation, they waited and they waited. And then this crazy guy shows up on the scene that we call John the Baptizer. John the Baptist, maybe you've heard of him. You'll read about him in the early chapters of the Gospels. And he was this radical coming out of the wilderness, calling people to turn to God and be ready for the coming of the Christ. And he identifies Jesus and is used by God to indicate the one who is coming. But his whole ministry was to prepare people for that moment. Breakthrough was coming. John was just the one preparing the way for that breakthrough. And then you had Jesus in his public ministry teaching people, modeling what it meant to have real relationship with the Father, and performing miracles, signs, and wonders, and healings that captured people's attentions in various places at various times, all to prepare them for what ultimately was going to happen. But this particular text we're going to look at today was a unique moment of prophetic fulfillment that was intended to prepare people for what was about to unfold. Fulfilled prophecy is one of the ways that God captures our attention for the significant things that he's doing. And it's part of how he prepares us for a breakthrough. Luke 19, verse 28. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethphage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples ahead, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying that colt?' then just say to them that the Lord needs it." Those who were sent ahead went, and they found this colt just as Jesus had told them. And as they were untying the colt, just like Jesus said, its owners asked them, "Hey, what are you doing? Why are you untying the colt?" And they replied, "The Lord needs it." They brought it to Jesus. They threw their cloaks, their outer garments, on the colt, and they put Jesus on it. And as he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. And when he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles that they had seen. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord," they shouted. "Peace in heaven, glory in the highest." The other gospel writers indicate that they also quoted Psalm 118, saying, "Save now, Hosea na, Lord, save now. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." The Pharisees, recognizing what the people were attributing to Jesus, were very jealous and upset. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples. Tell them to stop it." And Jesus said, "I tell you, if they keep quiet, the stones themselves will cry out." In Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, a prophecy that was written over 400 years before Jesus was born, it says this: "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion," referring to Israel at the time. "Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Zechariah 9, 9. With explicit detail, Zechariah foresaw and described what we now refer to as Palm Sunday, Jesus' triumphal entry into the city. But there's more. Psalm 118, verse 25 to 27, that some of the people were shouting, was penned by King David. And it also was a looking forward to when God would save his people. "Lord, save us. Hosea na. Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord, we bless you." And John, in his account of this experience, describes why the people went out from the city with palm branches to welcome Jesus into Jerusalem. It was a powerful moment. "The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine on us." Psalm 118, verse 27. "With bows in hand, join in the festal procession up to the horns of the altar," which was the symbol of where atonement for sins took place. But there's more. Daniel chapter 9, verse 25. Now, this one is a little more difficult to explain, but the angel was disclosing to Daniel what would happen in future years. And again, 500 plus years before Jesus was born, it was disclosed to him, "Know and understand this. From the time that the word goes out to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until the anointed one, the ruler, comes, there will be 7 sevens and 62 sevens. Let's go back to what he's referring to first when he talks about the rebuilding of Jerusalem. In fulfillment of the Lord's word to his people in Deuteronomy chapter 28, he said that if you put me behind your back, if you keep me on the periphery and you don't allow me to be the center of your life and the one who reveals truth and guides you in the way, then there'll be consequences that will come. And ultimately, you'll be taken off of your land and you'll be disciplined for a period of time. The prophets leading up to the time of the exile said that a day was coming when the Lord was going to take them off of the land and scatter them among the nations. This happened in the 500s BC, 586 BC, one of the last excursions of people, the exiling of people off of the land. So what is being revealed to Daniel in this passage is that from the time that a word goes out for the restoration and the rebuilding of Jerusalem after the exile, which happened March 5th, 444 BC, through the declaration of Cyrus, the king of Persia, he began to allow people to go back to Jerusalem and rebuild it. And when the declaration was given for the rebuilding of the city until the time that Jesus came into the city of Jerusalem, heralded as a king, was 483 years to the day. I would love to take the time to explain to you the math on both calendars, our calendar and the calendar that was used at the time of the day, as to how that can be calculated. But to the day, from the time of the declaration to the time that Jesus came in and what we call the triumphal entry on that Palm Sunday, was exactly 483 years, seven sevens and 62 sevens. So that captured people's attention, especially with the disciples after the fact. And that's why John in John chapter 12, verse 16 says, at first his disciples didn't understand all of this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him and that these things had been done to him. What you have access to is a collection of ancient documents that are unique to every other collection of writings in the world, in all of human history. I know for some of you, maybe generationally, it seems like an archaic book that doesn't seem relevant for your life today. Yet it has been 100% accurate in everything that has been predicted to date. Nothing else that has ever been disclosed to humanity has that kind of track record, and it warrants us paying attention to its message. This is a collection of writings through which, with all of its gory details of the fall of humanity and how we treat one another, it shows this one unified message of a God who longs for relationship with his created, the being most created in his image and likeness to be restored. He wants relationship restored with the peoples of this planet. And he's gone to great lengths to reveal that plan and his purposes, and has predicted things in advance that have come to pass exactly like what he has said. In the original languages of the Koine Greek, this is a credible collection of writings. Despite popular criticism, there are over 14,000 manuscripts or fragments of manuscripts that verify the accuracy and the credibility of what we have as the New Testament. And with the find of the Dead Sea Scrolls, we have now a closer comparison to make with the original, what would have been the original documents of the Old Testament, and the copies of the Old Testament that we have today. And it has overwhelmingly shown that these documents were retained with accuracy and credibility, preserved miraculously for such a time as this. And within it is this single unified message drawing the hearts of people back to God. You and I have an opportunity to be prepared for those moments that God orchestrates to bring breakthrough in our lives. But if we're not aware of the message, if we're not aware of what God has said in advance about what is coming, then we're going to be clueless when the things start to unfold. Now, the last thing that I want to do before we make application is to talk about God's heart in all of this. You see it in verse 41 to 44. God longs for us to experience breakthrough, and he goes to great lengths to prepare us to recognize when that is happening. As Jesus approached Jerusalem, verse 41, and saw the city, Luke records that Jesus cried. He wept over the city. To my knowledge, there's only two times recorded in the Gospels when Jesus cried, when he wept. The first is recorded in John 11, when Jesus was grieving with his friends over the death of their brother Lazarus. Even though he knew that he was going to raise Lazarus from the dead, Jesus entered in. His heart was tied in with his friends and with the grieving people, with grieving humanity. Jesus was moved and he wept. The second is in this passage. By the way, John records that one of the main reasons that people went out of the city to meet Jesus as he came in was because they had heard the report that Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead, and they wanted to see Lazarus as well as Jesus. The second time that I'm aware of that this is recorded is in this passage, Jesus weeping over the city of Jerusalem. And he said, if you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. You've persisted in your unbelief. You've seen the miracles, but you remain skeptical. You've heard the teaching, but it has not penetrated into the depths of your heart. And so you do not recognize this breakthrough moment and how significant it is. He goes on to say, the days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and the children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. Jesus predicted the fall of Jerusalem the second time, and that prediction was fulfilled over 35 years after Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. A powerful prediction of what would happen in their future. The verification of that reality of what God brought about is captured in the coinage of Rome, symbolized on the right by conquering Rome, holding Judea in subjugation to its empire. It's also captured on the Ark of Titus, the Roman general that led the Roman armies in the sacking of Jerusalem in 70 AD. Outside of the Colosseum, you can still see it today, on a major thoroughfare where people and entertainers and events were paraded into the Colosseum for everyone's fascination. They passed the Ark of Titus, which has continued to herald this reality of what God permitted in discipline of his people because they did not recognize the time. You see the Jewish menorah in the details of the relief on the Ark of Titus. You also see various elements of temple worship being carried off to Rome. On April 12th of 1959, John F. Kennedy gave a speech, and I read the text of that speech this week. He was addressing those that were concerned about the education of African Americans within the United States, and he was talking about how critical of a moment it was to be able to see that education through. And he said that there is a Chinese word for crisis, and that word is composed of two characters, one which represents danger and the other representing opportunity. Now, I've read articles about that speech and about that clarification. And the second character more means incipient moment. It doesn't mean that opportunity is going to be taken, but there's a critical moment in the midst of danger that makes it a crisis. And what we do in the midst of that crisis will determine what comes after. I wonder, in God's permitting of the spread of the coronavirus, I wonder what kind of an opportunity, a season of opportunity that we are in. As a staff and elders of Lake Gregory Church, we're captured in our hearts by this very sobering season, sad, dire for many, and yet filled with questions and opportunities for conversations that point people to hope. I believe that God can use these difficult, dangerous times to bring people to faith. It can be a breakthrough moment. It may be the season and the moment that people will point back to in their future that said, that was a turning point in my heart in relationship to God. Maybe that was a time where I really turned and trusted God to get us through what we went through. I wonder if we'll be able to look back and say, you know, this was a unique time of harvest, maybe an answer to our prayers, that God would do whatever it would take to make himself known and to hold out hope to people in a unique way that might actually connect and bring breakthrough in their hearts by faith. So how do we prepare for breakthrough? How do we not miss the critical moment of opportunity in our time? What would the Lord want us doing to align ourselves with him in our days? Here's some suggestions, and these come not just off the top of my head. I've read a number of books about great awakenings, revivals throughout human history, movements of God, and they have some common characteristics to them, and I want to highlight what some of those are. The first one I'm going to highlight here is to just pay attention. Go into the scriptures, listen to what God has said, and hear the voice of God's Spirit speaking about what is happening. God gives us perspective through his word. And I've listed a number of passages, prophetic passages, up on the screen that would warrant your attention. Honestly, one of my biggest concerns is that as we continue to progress forward in our times, that people will not be prepared for the counterfeit Christ that the scripture indicates will come on the scene of humanity. So powerfully, so miraculously, so smooth that people will believe the lie. And Jesus said it'll be so powerful, so attention-getting, that even the elect would be deceived if that were possible. That is my biggest concern as we move towards the end of this particular age. And you're not going to be alert to what really is going on if you don't know what God has revealed over the centuries about this next season of time that is coming. Some other things that the scripture holds out to us that is preparatory, like with the coming of John the Baptist before Jesus' public ministry, we are called to repent. There are different seasons of opportunity that we realign ourselves with God in our attitudes and in our actions. We're called to turn to God. It's an evidence of true faith. It's a faith response to God to turn to him and also to receive the one that he has provided for our forgiveness and restored relationship. We need to receive Christ, turn and trust in Christ. Acts chapter 20, Paul said that is the message that he took among every people in every city and every village that he went to share the good news. He called people to turn and to trust in Jesus the Christ. Another thing that we can do is take tangible steps of preparation. The most notable of those throughout the scriptures and throughout history is people realizing that the circumstances of their lives are bigger than they can handle on their own. And as a result of that, they formed circles to pray. Most of the great awakenings throughout history occurred as people formed circles to pray. One was a businessman's circle, and it started with just a handful of people getting together to pray for God to make himself known in their times. That prayer meeting grew and multiplied, and the lives of thousands and tens of thousands of people were changed because it became a breakthrough moment from God to their hearts. We need to be daily being devoted to the Lord. I heard Tony Evans, I listened to a message on breakthrough by him this morning, and he said that yesterday's word from God is not sufficient for the circumstances of today. And if we aren't daily listening to God, if we aren't daily moving through the scriptures and praying and opening our hearts to what God is saying in our specific situations, we won't be ready for breakthrough. We won't see it or benefit from it when it happens. And we can get ourselves into a posture, not a physical posture, but maybe physically, spiritually, psychologically, being alert and formatted in such a way that we can recognize and identify what God is doing. Tony Evans also said that listening to the scripture is like a general weather forecast, but being in tune with the Spirit of God as you read the scripture makes it personal. God gives you specific direction in your set of circumstances as you walk with him. That's preparation. And then that should lead to making courageous choices. The fifth bullet point in that list there is making courageous choices, like Cindy's and my friend from Kansas, who is a little bit older than us, but decided to form a Facebook group called Be the Light. And I want you to hear what she said in the establishment of this group. She said, "Hello, everyone. I created this site to share goodness and light. Right now, the entire world is engulfed in fighting the coronavirus. Simultaneously, we are seeing so much human kindness and compassion. In the midst of isolating ourselves, there is also a coming together that has been desperately needed for a long time. Where people are experiencing pain and loss, others are stepping into those gaps in a myriad of creative ways. Feel free to post and share how you or others are sharing light and hope." And one of the people that posted on that site said, "At 82 years of age, I love sharing my faith with people when they call me. It's exciting to know that God will use us until He takes us, continuing to spread cheer and hope." People sharing the gospel, encouraging each other, lifting up things that will lift up the eyes of others to the hope that God offers us. Even on a practical level, there was a story of a teacher whose student was struggling with their math while they were doing it in a home environment. So the teacher took a whiteboard, went to the child's home, stood outside the picture window, and walked them through the struggle that they were having with their math. Those are beautiful, uplifting things, practical ways that we can engage and bring light to others. I don't know what it is that you are longing for breakthrough in your own life and relationships. God knows. I believe that your longings indicate where that breakthrough is needed. But whatever it is, this challenge of this message is to get to a different vantage point, to allow God through His Word and by His Spirit to take you to a different place where you can see the bigger picture and you can begin to understand your part in the unfolding of God's plan. And it will bring tremendous renewal to your life, your faith, your relationships. In every area of your life will be impacted by a breakthrough that God brings in you. All of this at the beginning of Passion Week is so timely because the ultimate breakthrough happened on the cross and on that Sunday morning that followed in the resurrection of Jesus. God powerfully confirming that this was the way, that He was tearing the veil and opening up the door for restored relationship with Him. Jesus' death on the cross, satisfying God's justice and making forgiveness of sins possible, and the resurrection of Jesus opening the door to a life forever restored with our Creator. I'm going to ask you to pray with me as we prepare our hearts to make the most of God's breakthrough opportunity in our day. Let's pray. Father, I want to ask that You, by Your Spirit, would open up our eyes and open up our ears, open up our hearts, and enable us to receive the positive change and the good that You want to accomplish in us and through us and around us. I pray that this season of opportunity will be an opportunity to reflect and hear and respond and be in a better position to serve Your purposes with our lives beyond it. And even in the midst of it. So God, please do that in Jesus' name. I also pray, Lord, for and with those who are just beginning to see the clarity with which God has communicated His heart and desire for us to know Him. And I invite you to pray a prayer with me. Just repeat these phrases either in your heart or out loud as I say them a phrase at a time. Father God, thank You for this moment of opportunity. I acknowledge my sin, of shutting you out and living selfishly. I'm sorry. Through what Jesus did for me, I open my heart to you. Thank you for pursuing me. Thank you for coming after me. And thank you for calling me to turn and to put my trust in you. Forgive my sin. Come into my life and make me new. And I thank you for hearing my prayer. I don't know what this adventure is going to look like, but I'm going to take my steps with you leading the way. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus, what?
Jesus.